square inch of additional rib-eye area means at least $4 extra carcass cutout value in a 600-pound carcass. The whole beef cattle business evolves around the principle of obtaining the most pounds of beef per cow bred.
People are involved with raising food to earn a living. And economics is often difficult for today's consumers to say the economic factor comes into play first. I will say to you that the humane handling of animals takes priority over the economics.
No producer will make changes unless it's economically viable to do so in the long run. I think that there's always a few exceptions to that, but in general, unless it really makes a large benefit to the hen and that gives me some sort of measurable return, changes won't be made.
That's tomorrow, same time and station, for this business of farming.
I do believe that animal welfare is important to these people, but at the same time, they are caught in a system that is economically driven, and it requires that they use certain husbandry techniques at this time in order to compete.
The meat and dairy industries are so powerful and have been pushing their agenda for so long, they have some very deep roots everywhere. The stock market has its roots in livestock market. Farm animals, large ones, are called livestock. They have deep roots in the school system. They provide literature for the schools to teach the children a certain way. Then they have roots in the judicial system. They have roots in the legislatures.
The meat industry that we have today are spending millions and millions of dollars, and they understand that if you're going to perpetuate the myth that we have, they have to start early. If you take McDonald's, Ronald McDonald, Playland, telling kids that hamburgers come from the hamburger patch, there's no truth to that. But what would it be like if McDonald's said to kids, you know, really a hamburger is dead cow? What would happen if people had to go up to the counter and order a dead cow burger instead of something that sounds as glorious as a Big Mac? And it's not only McDonald's, but it's the dairy industry, and it's putting the information into our schools, the wonderful coloring books of how wonderful the animals have it and how great it is and how much they enjoy being out there. And as they are well taken care of and having a good time, then all of a sudden they end up going very happily to the slaughterhouse. Well, I will tell you right now, I have seen thousands and thousands of animals go to the slaughterhouse. I have never seen one of them that ever went running, skipping, and jumping and saying, "Yippee skippy, I'm going to be a McDonald's hamburger."
Part of what is at stake here, obviously, is power and wealth and property, and anything that threatens that is something that we're going to try to, those who have the power are going to try to prevent from threatening them. So I think that we should think of the relationship behind the scenes, as it were, between humans and other animals, is that every day anyone is a party to the death of an animal. It's an exercise in human power over property, over a thing.
At last, the steers have nearly fulfilled their destiny. On the beef dressing floor, the dressed sides move.
There is a law in Canada which says that all animals should be humanely killed, which means that they should in some way be rendered unconscious before they are killed. Chickens, and to a large extent pigs, are made unconscious using electric shock. I think that the way that we do that is open to question, and I think there may be better methods for doing that.
The idea of humane slaughter is like an oxymoron to me. It's like military intelligence, you know. I mean, the two ideas don't go together very well. But even if there was, by some wild invention, some way of killing animals without causing them pain, still wouldn't justify killing them.
If the cow had a choice of one road that went to the slaughterhouse and one road that went to the grassland, that cow would probably go and want to live.
Well, you know, you always have to think. Now, if I was an old cow, and we shouldn't, I mean, we as humans cannot put ourselves in animal circumstances. But I believe that they, if they had their choices about whether they'd like to go out to the grassland and be surrounded by a wolf or a couple of coyotes and meet their death that way versus being humanely transported to a slaughter facility where they are humanely and instantly killed, what choice would they take? I can't speak for that animal, but one wonders.
The animals who are raised for food have had their biography ended. They had a life story. They were a somebody in the world rather than a something in the world. And their story was unfolding, and we terminated it. We ended it. We killed them before their time, before the fullness of their life.
These food production systems and the people that are involved have nothing to hide about what we're doing. Every effort is made to ensure, first of all, safety of the people and the animals, and for health reasons, the sanitary elements of what is necessary to produce safe food. Because of those two things, walking into a slaughter plant unannounced just can't be done.